now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
A Sunday with Comedy, with It Pays to Be Ignorant, The Stan Freberg Show, Dellie Ellis in A Date with Judy, The Magnificent Montague starring Monty Woolley, and we'll wrap it all up with another episode of The Voice Machine with Dr. Roebling and Superman. That's all coming up on this Sunday. This is the 11th day of August, already getting into it here, 224th day of the year, 142 days left. Arapaho became the first American ship to use the SOS distress signal on this date in 1909. In 1934, the first inmates arrived at the federal prison on Alcatraz Island in San Francisco Bay. King Hussein of Jordan ascended to the throne on this date in 1952 after his father had been declared mentally unfit. He was just 16 years old. In 1965, following the arrest of a young black motorist, the predominantly black neighborhood of Watts in Los Angeles erupted in riots that lasted 6 days and left 34 dead.
He's not going to come down here and drag no more people out of the cars and five cops jump on him. None of that's going to happen no more.
That's right.
The man came down and he called one of the fellas while he was getting out of the car. He called it drunk driving. Now, five police against one boy. It's not nobody around just coming from outside doing no wrong. It's people that live here that grew up in this old little neighborhood. And they're going to pop up and jump on everybody.
The Watts substation in 77th Division is under fire right now by a sniper. They were under fire earlier by a sniper from a rooftop, and that sniper was killed by a National Guardsman.
The sounds of Watts on this date in 1965. David Berkowitz, son of Sam, arrested outside his Yonkers home on this date in 1977. He was thought to be and later convicted of being the son of Sam.
Well, Sam did it through me. He used me. He made me go out there and do it. I did it for him, for blood, so he can have the blood.
Now, in 1979, David Berkowitz admitted the demon story was invented by his wild imagination so as to find some form of justification for, as he said, my criminal acts against society. He remains in jail to this day. In fact, his parole was denied back in June of this year. You would think an ex-radio man would be careful when he's anywhere near a microphone. But on this date in 1984, President Reagan got official Russia all a Twitter at a wisecrack during a sound check for his weekly radio address.
Кто-то и записал его на магнитофонную ленту. Вот прослушайте эту запись.
And my fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We begin bombing in 5 minutes.
Газетный концерн Галнет опубликовал его в своих газетах.
Radio Moscow. Now, most commentators dismissed the joke as, at worst, poor taste. Nonetheless, it got geopolitical traction because it came at a time of heightened Cold War tension between Washington and Moscow, which largely dissolved during Reagan's second term. The joke also entered the popular culture. In a novelette by Charles Stross, A Colder War, the Soviets regarded the joke as a serious presidential message and responded by triggering World War III. No taking anyone out to the ball game, as on this date in 1994, Major League Baseball went on strike.
It's a case of two greedy kids that can't get together. You know, you got owners that want to make millions and millions, and you got ball players who want to make as much as they possibly can, and the only people who get it in the end are the fans.
They have a very hard time being sympathetic to somebody whose average salary is $1 million a year. Break up my heart.
I think the players and the owners deserve each other. It's kind of difficult to get excited about millionaires fighting millionaires.
Baseball came to a screeching halt and didn't return for 232 days. The strike canceled the rest of the 1994 season, and for the first time since 1904, even the World Series. The United Nations voted on this date in 2006 for a resolution to end 4 weeks of bloodshed between Israel and Hezbollah guerrillas.
With the deployment and withdrawal, a full ceasefire will go into effect. And the Council has said that it intends to adopt another resolution with further measures to help that ceasefire become permanent.
U.S. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, both sides claiming victory in the conflict. Passing away on this date in history, Phil Harris.
While I was walking down the beach one bright and sunny day, I saw a great big wooden box a-floating in the bay. I pulled it in and opened it up, and much to my surprise, ooh, I discovered a... Right before my eyes, ooh, I discovered a... Right before my eyes.
His biggest record hit, The Thing, Phil Harris, passing away on this date in 1995. Also industrialist Andrew Carnegie, actor Peter Cushing, the wonderful Robin Williams, Trini Lopez, wonderful singer, also the man behind Viacom and CBS, Sumner Redstone, Anne Heche, the actress and ex of Ellen DeGeneres, and the wonderful Mike Douglas.
There's a boy outside. His name is Lee. He wants to carry my books for me. Can he, Daddy? Is it all right, Dad? He's got freckles, Dad.
The man in my little girl's life. The man in my little girl's life.
Singer and talk show host Mike Douglas, who ironically passed away on this date in 2006, which was his 81st birthday. Others celebrating birthdays today. Actor Lloyd Nolan, historian, novelist Alex Haley, Arlene Dahl, whose son is Lorenzo Lamas, born on this date in history, and preacher and politician Jerry Falwell, all born on this date.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcement. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
From Step Up in the Cheaper by the Dozen remake, Allison Stoner, 31. Thor in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Chris Hemsworth, 41. From Breaking Bad, Anna Gunn is 56. Comedian, TV host, MMA commentator Joe Rogan is 57. From won an Academy Award and a Tony Award, won an Emmy for How to Get Away with Murder, Viola Davis is 59. Well, let me tell you something, brother. Hulk Hogan is 71 today. I did a horrible job with that. Apple's Steve Wozniak is 72. Country's John Connolly is 78. And rock singer Eric Carmen, 75. Little of the gentler side of Eric Carmen, Never Gonna Fall in Love Again, also Make Me Lose Control, his big hit. Eric Carmen celebrating his 75th birthday today. Those just a few of the people celebrating the 11th day of August is their birthday. If this is your birthday,
we baked you a birthday cake. If you get it to me, eh? And you moan and groan and woe, don't forget we told you so.
Happy birthday!
Happy birthday! Make a wish, dear, and blow out the candles.
Here they go.
And we'll get started with It Pays to Be Ignorant, going back 80 years to August 11th, 1944, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
There's an issue cutting through the partisanship in Congress. It's AM radio.
The overwhelming majority of legislators, Democrats and Republicans, support a bill to keep AM radio in cars. But time is running out. Text AM to 52886 and ask Congress to bring this bill to the floor for a vote now. AM radio is too important to let this moment pass us by.
Message and data rates may apply. You may receive up to 4 messages a month, and you may text STOP to STOP.
This message furnished by the National Association of Broadcasters.
Okay, now I believe that this is an Armed Forces radio recording of It Pays to Be Ignorant, even though I didn't hear any mentions of it during the show. There may be one that I just missed, but there are no commercials in this, which is interesting because at the time the show was sponsored by Philip Morris, and where commercials are, there are extra musical tunes that sound like they were edited in. So let's listen to this, though, because it gives you an idea of the weird sense of humor of this show. It Pays to Be Ignorant. 80 years ago, August 11th, 1944.
What is an optimist?
A person who does a crossword puzzle in ink.
Correct. Pay that man $8. What do they call the inhabitants of Egypt?
People.
Correct. Pay that man $9 because...
It pays to be ignorant. The zaniest of quiz shows, rebroadcast for the American Armed Forces and their allies, and featuring Al Trace's orchestra, Lula McConnell, Harry McNaughton, George Shelton, and the man who knows it pays to be ignorant, Tom Howard.
First, the expert is Mr. Harry McNaughton, that celebrated author who has just written a book entitled How to Shop Without Annoying a Sales Girl or The Hand is Quicker Than the Eye. But here he is, Mr. Harry McNaughton.
I have a poem, Mr. Howard.
I see.
How I long for the gay old 90s. I wish those days would come back. The girls of today don't wear girdles. Things are getting pretty slack. Little thing I coppered off an old beer bottle.
Okay, you should have left it there. Next, we have a woman who is flattered when you call her a flying fortress. She just loved to be 29. A woman who talks so much her husband had lockjaw for 2 years before they knew it. Here she is in the flesh, and when I say flesh, I speak loosely. Miss Lulu McConnell.
You're the second one that has insulted me today.
Yeah?
First, it was our garbage collector.
How did he insult you, as if I care?
Well, I'd forgotten to put the garbage can out. So when I heard the truck coming, I called him and said, am I too late for the garbage?
What did he say?
He said, no, hop in.
Hop in.
Charming fellow.
And you call that an insult?
Certainly. He knows I can't jump that high.
I see. You could at least try. Next, we have a man who dislikes to drink his coffee out of a cup because the spoon gets in his eye. A man who is so cheap, he'd steal the whistle from Whistler's mother. Here he is, Mr. George Shelton.
Say, Mr. Howard, can you tell me the time, the right time?
The time? Well, about 4 minutes after 9.
That does it. That's the last straw.
Now, what's the matter?
All day long, ever since this morning, I've been asking people the time.
Yeah.
And everybody tells me something different.
Uh-huh.
I can't believe anybody anymore.
No, I see, people are very two-faced.
Oh, they are two-faced.
Okay, let's get on here. Mr. Shelton, your head reminds me of the face on the barroom floor. Oh,
that's silly. The face on the barroom floor was a woman's face.
I know. It's the floor your head reminds me of. Well, there they are, folks. Three living examples of the fact that life can be horrible. Now, here's the first question. Pay attention, see if we can get it. After what Central American Republic is the Panama Canal named?
Just a minute now. Let me think.
Yeah, what with?
Doesn't that Panama Canal, doesn't that join the Atlantic and the Pacific?
Ah, the Atlantic and Pacific is a tea company.
No, wait a minute. Just a minute.
Well, I ought to know. I was thrown out of there for teas and coffee.
For teas and coffee. That's terrible.
Yeah, I had no grounds to say that.
No, you had no grounds. All right. Mr. McNaughton is right. The Panama Canal joins the Atlantic and Pacific.
You mean they took in a partner?
What do you mean a partner?
Boy, that's going to be a long name. the Atlantic and Pacific and Panama Canal Tea Company.
Wait a minute. We're not talking about a tea company. The Panama Canal joins the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans.
Boy, that's some canal, 3,000 miles long.
No. Mr. Sheldon, the continent tapers down so that the Panama Canal is only about 40 miles wide. It runs through the Isthmus of Panama.
Yeah, of course. It runs through what?
The Isthmus of Panama. Isthmus.
Why don't you try saying it with your teeth in?
With your teeth
in? Oh, he did. He said Isthmus. You know, like that song, I'm Dreaming of a White Isthmus?
Find out the country the Panama Canal is named after. The Panama Canal runs through this country, and we pay them $250,000 a year rental.
My word. I knew rents had gone up, but that's terrible.
Yeah.
How many rooms has it got?
Please, wait a minute.
I say, tell me another thing. Does that include gas and electricity?
It must. For that money, you should get maid service.
Yeah.
Does it include meals?
Look, the question is about the Panama Canal. Now, let's straighten it out.
You mean it's all bent?
It's all... Look, the Panama Canal runs through a certain country.
Mr. Howard, why be so evasive? What country does it run through?
Look, that's what I'm trying to find out. That's the answer to the question. We pay this country $250,000 a year for the use of the land that the canal runs across.
You mean we pay that money for a vacant lot?
Well, not exactly a vacant...
Well, if it's not a vacant lot, there must be something on it.
There is clear thinking.
Thank you, Mr. McGorton. And if there is something on it, we want to know how many rooms.
Now, will you pay attention? The canal is 40 miles long.
A house 40 miles long?
No.
I wouldn't like that. Take all day to dust it.
I didn't say it was a house.
But you said it wasn't a vacant lot.
Well, maybe it's an office building.
No, it's a canal.
Oh, a canal. What's the name of the canal, Mr. Howard?
Please, I told you, the Panama Canal.
Oh, I use that perfume.
Perfume?
Canal number 5.
Canal number 5. Here is the next question. Now, see if we can get little results with this one. If I had 4 apples and someone gave me 2 bananas, how many apples will I have?
Mr. Howard, may I venture an opinion?
Certainly.
I think that's a very foolish question.
Well, now, there's a very encouraging sign. Why do you think it's foolish?
Because you can't add bananas to apples and get apples.
No. Certainly not. When you add apples to bananas, you get fruit salad.
Fruit salad.
Besides, where are you going to get bananas these days? Answer me that.
That's beside the point.
Oh, so that's it. You're evading the question, are you?
Yeah, how do you like that? Suppose we invaded your question.
Look, the question is...
Where are you going to get bananas these days?
That is not the question.
Oh, yes, it is. Just because you can't answer, don't say it isn't the question. I heard Miss McConnell's question.
You're quite right, Mr. Sheldon. That was Miss McConnell's question.
Certainly.
If you can't answer it, Mr. Howard, come out like a man and say so.
But we're not interested in Miss McConnell's question.
Speak for yourself, John Alden.
Look.
I, for one, am definitely interested in Miss McConnell's question.
I agree with you, Mr. McNaughton. I think Miss McConnell's question is the most fascinating question I've heard all week.
Yes.
Don't you think so, Miss McConnell?
What was the question?
Heaven help the sailors on a night like this. Look, the question is, where are you going to get bananas to eat? Wait a minute.
That's a good question. Who thought that up?
That is not the question.
That is... Oh, so now you're going to change it. Too hard for you to answer, huh?
Isn't that just like him, you know? Right. Suppose we did that.
Look, the question is, how long is the Panama Canal? Wait a minute. You got me in an awful state here.
What's the name of the state, Mr. Howard?
Maybe he's in Florida.
Oh, Maine, you know, is very nice this time of year.
Oh, please, I'm going nuts.
You're going nuts? Oh, I don't think you like it up there. Too many mosquitoes.
Yeah, and the food is terrible.
I see.
So, Mr. Howard, why don't you go up to Martha's Vineyard? You'll like Martha,
I
lovely
like
girl.
Will you please make some attempt to answer the question? If I had 4 apples and someone gave me 2 bananas, how many apples will I have?
Where are you going to get bananas these days?
Please.
glad they got out of that one. This is the worst thing yet. Gentlemen, this is the first. Say, what is this? What are you? Now we come to that part of the program where we ask the studio audience to help us out. We've invited two members of the audience up here on the stage. And while Mr. Roberts is getting our guests seated, can we have some music from our good friend, Dr. Novick, and his orchestra? This evening, Mr. Roberts.
Our first guest, Mr. Howard, is Coxswain Roger Beard of the United States Navy.
Oh, how do you do? Good for the Navy. Good evening, sir. We're glad you came up. Takes courage to face these three vacant minds we have here. Where are you from, would you care to tell us? That is, where's your hometown?
I'm from Minneapolis, Minnesota.
Minneapolis, Minnesota. My. Great town.
Minneapolis, Minnesota.
That's right.
Well, put soap in my mouth and call me Bubbles.
Uh-huh.
You know, I used to work in that town.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I was a sculptor in a restaurant.
Oh, I say, you were a sculptor in a restaurant?
Yeah, I used to chisel my meals.
Very cute.
All right. You know, Roger, I never forget the last war. They put me in 8F.
Why did they put you in 8F?
I had two sons in 4F.
You did?
Made me eight.
I hope these morons are not annoying you, Walter. Would you tell us a little more about yourself? We're sort of interested.
Yeah, what's your first name, honey?
Rog.
What?
Rog.
Roger?
Rog, he called.
Oh, Rog. Ain't that cute, Mr. Howard?
Yes,
Rog.
My name.
He's a cute little kid, too, ain't he?
All right, he's very nice boy.
Oh, he sure is as sweet as peaches.
All right.
Well, you can just call me Jake.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm one of the boys.
You're one of the boys. Well, whichever one of the boys you are, he isn't going to like it. Will you pick a question out of the hat for us, Roger, please? And would you be kind enough to read the question, if you don't mind?
What are shoe trees used for?
Oh, very good. What are shoe trees used for? Now, there's a good question.
Oh, indeed it is a good question, rather. I love questions about trees, you know. It brings out the woodsman in me.
I see. It also brings out the sap. I'm talking about shoe trees.
I never knew shoes grew on trees.
I see. Miss McCown, with the proper diet, and if you take real good care of yourself, you have excellent chances of being a moron, if you know what I mean.
I'm not interested.
No.
No, I belong to too many lodges now.
All right, say. Miss McCown, do you know what a shoe tree is?
I'm afraid I don't, no. I'm a heel, ain't I?
Yeah, you certainly are. That goes without saying. Mr. Sheldon, let me ask you a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
What do you put in your shoes when you take them off at night?
Are you supposed to take your shoes off at night?
You know, speaking of shoes, I had a perfectly good pair of patent leather shoes, but they all cracked up on me.
Nah. What happened to them?
I don't know. I suppose the patent must have run out.
The patent must have run out, yeah.
My old man bought a pair of police shoes the other day, but he don't like them.
He don't like police shoes?
No. Every time he puts them on, they pinch his feet.
They pinch his feet. That's very, very funny, Miss McCoy.
I bought my wife a pair of alligator shoes the other day.
My God, I didn't know alligators wore shoes.
No. Wait a minute. Let's get on here. Mr. McNaughton means the shoes were made from alligators.
Boy, she must have big feet.
Yeah, oh, no. Hey,
you mean every time his wife wants a pair of shoes, they gotta kill an alligator?
No, that isn't a thought.
Well, have you know, Mr. Sheldon, my wife has very dainty feet.
Yeah?
Yes, but she puts them in the strangest places.
She puts them in the strangest places.
Say, what size shoes do you take, Miss McConnell?
Well, I take a 6. But 7 feels so good, I buy an 8.
You buy an 8?
Well, I imagine 8s would feel better.
Oh, yes, indeedy. When I used to wear a 7, I had a corn on the top of my toe. But now the corn is on the bottom of my foot.
Do you find that an improvement?
Oh, sure. Now, no one can step on it but me.
No one. Look, can we please get back to the question? Can any of you tell me what shoe trees are used for?
Well, why don't you ask the man you bought them from?
I didn't buy them.
Well, where did you get them?
Look, I haven't got any shoe
trees. Then what do you care where they come from?
Why don't you mind your own business?
Yeah. All right, never mind. Will you cut it out?
Mr. Howard, what was the question again, please?
Where can you buy bananas these days?
That is not the question. What is this? What's happening? Thank you. Who is our next guest, Mr. Roberts?
Our next guest, Mr. Howard, is Staff Sergeant Mary Field of the Women's Army Corps.
Oh. How do you do, Miss Field? This is indeed a pleasure. We're very, very happy to have you with us.
Oh, very charming girl, isn't she, Mr. Howard?
All right, she is a charming
rather.
Girl.
You know, it's girls like her that make me like girls like her.
I see. Very cute. I wish you'd do me a favor, Mr. McNaughton, and stop embarrassing our guest here. Miss Fields, pay no attention to them. They're beginning to get into their second childhood. Where is your hometown? Would you care to tell us?
I certainly would. It's Cleveland, Ohio.
Cleveland, Ohio. That's a great town. Been in Cleveland many, many times. You didn't happen to work in May's department store there, did you?
No, I didn't.
That's
but...
down on the square, isn't
I know.
It? Yeah, I've been through there in the bargain basement many times. What are you doing in New York, may I ask? Are you visiting here or are you stationed here?
I'm stationed here.
Oh, I see.
Recruiting.
Oh, recruiting. Well, my, that's swell. You like your work in the service?
Yes, I do.
How long have you been in New York?
I have been in New York for a year and a half.
Oh, a year and a half. Then you've been around New York quite some. How do you compare the boys in New York with the boys in Cleveland? Or are you married? Maybe before. Are you married?
No, I'm not married.
Well, then you can answer that question. What would you say?
Well,
that...
most of the boys from Cleveland are in New York, so that's all right. Oh.
You don't mean by that you brought them with you. They just happen to be
they
here.
They just happen to be here.
Well, that's fine. Have you met Mayor LaGuardia yet?
No, I haven't.
No.
I'll tell you how you can meet him. If you see a big hat walking around, just look on him.
Would you care to tell us, Mr.
You know, I just got a postcard from a girl in Chicago.
Yeah, what'd she say?
Oh, I don't know. There's no writing on it.
No writing on it?
No, well, you see, she's not speaking to me.
Oh. I just got a letter the other day from an old girl of mine.
Yeah?
Boy, was she dumb. She used to sign her name with a cross.
Uh-huh.
Sign her name with a cross?
Yeah, now she signs it with a circle.
Really? Oh. How come?
Huh?
How come?
Well, she got married. She changed her name, I guess.
Oh, I see. Pay no attention. May I ask you, what did you do in Cleveland before you joined?
Well, I did many things. Most of my time was spent in newspaper work, advertising newspaper work.
Advertising? What newspaper? Do you want to give it a plug?
Why, certainly, Cleveland Shopping News.
Oh, the Cleveland what?
Shopping News.
Oh, the Cleveland Shopping News.
That's
I thought you
right.
said Shopping News. I can't hear very good, you know, at my age, everything goes back on you. Well, we're more than glad to... What do you intend to do after the war? Have you made any plans? That is, any post-war plans?
I'm afraid to think about it. I think we should get this war over with first and then think
well,
about it.
Well, that's very good. That's very good. That is, Miss Fields, a very good thought. And I want to tell you, I've enjoyed my interview with you immensely. Now,
I love her uniform.
Oh, you like her uniform.
Oh, she's swell. It's all cute, don't
yeah,
she?
Yeah.
Oh, that reminds me, I've just got to borrow some kind of a costume.
A costume?
Yeah. What? I'm going to a masquerade tomorrow night.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what to go as.
I see. Why don't you tie a rope around your waist and go as two bales of hay?
Why don't you put a rubber band around your head and go with me as a lead
pencil? All right. There'd be no point in that.
Boy, she pretty near made a mark out of you.
She made a mark out of me. I think you're right there, Mr. Sheldon. Well, I think we'd like to have our good friend here and guest help us out by picking a question out of the dunce cap, if she will. Any question you get a hold of, and would you be kind enough, Miss Fields, to read the question for us, please?
How long is a half-a-mile racetrack?
Please. Please, no help from the audience, please. How long is a half-a-mile racetrack? The question is about racetracks.
You know, I bet on a horse last week.
How long was it?
The horse?
No, the racetrack.
I don't know, but I know the horse was long coming in.
I see.
Did you bet him on the nose?
No, I bet on the whole horse.
Please, let's get on here. I'm afraid, Miss Fields, your question's going to take a little time. Will you offer Miss Fields a chair? I don't like to keep her standing there. Look, let's get on here with the question. Now, don't get away from it. How long is a half-mile racetrack?
I got a tip on a horse tomorrow. I'm going to bet my wad.
You're going to bet your wad?
Yep.
What are you going to have left to chew? Leave it. Will you leave that racing form alone and pay attention to the question?
Do you ever bet on horses, Mr. McNaughton?
Oh, rather, yes. You know, the last time I backed a horse, it cost me $50.
Cost you $50?
Yes, I backed him into a store window. The man was very annoyed, too.
Never mind. Let me tell you something. You guys are upsetting my gastric acidity here. Let's get on with the question, will you? Please.
Oh, boy. Here's a horse I gotta bet. Oh, he can't lose.
Where have I heard that before?
What makes you so sure he can't lose?
Says here, he's starting at 20 to 1, but the race don't start until 1 o'clock.
I see.
Well, you know, let me see now. That gives him a 20-minute start, doesn't it? He ought to win in a walk.
All right, he ought to win.
I don't like those horses that are supposed to win in a walk.
No.
When I bet on them, the other horses start running.
All right. Look, we have a guest there. Now, let's answer the question.
Yeah, exactly. Answer the... What was the question, Mr. Howard?
Where are you going to get bananas these days?
Will you cut it out? Will you forget about bananas?
Why, what's the matter with bananas?
I said nothing about bananas.
You certainly did. You said, let's forget about bananas.
Please.
Don't you like bananas, Mr. Howard?
Oh, I love bananas, Mr.
Well, where are you going to get them?
The question is, how long is a half-mile banana? I mean, wait a minute.
I wonder what this is going to be. Gosh. I'm going to turn the thing into a funeral here any minute. Will happen with this horse. There they go. There goes his option right there. About time for us to put the dummies back in the trunk again before they get us all in a flurry here.
Oh, I like that song.
What song?
The flurry with the fringe on top.
No, that's Surrey. Surrey.
Oh, no, Mr. Howard. Surrey is an Indian dish like the chicken Surrey or lamb Surrey.
No, that's curry.
Oh, there's another beautiful song. Curry me back to old Virginia.
I didn't say that. I said Surrey.
Oh, that's all right, old boy. Don't apologize.
Look. A Surrey is a big old-fashioned vehicle, square in the back with two skinny shafts sticking out of a big bulky body.
Now we're back to Miss McConnell again.
Oh, what's the old music, please?
It pays to be ignorant, to be dumb, to be dense, to be ignorant. It pays to be ignorant just like me.
There you are, folks. It's time to say goodnight for Harry McNaughton, Lulu McConnell, George Sheldon, Al Trace, and his band.
When I was just a school kid, I wasn't awfully bright. I had a pretty teacher who made me stay in each night, so you see it pays.
This is Tom Howard saying goodnight and good nonsense.
This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
Shows you how much attention I was paying. They gave the announcement that it was the an Armed Forces recording at the very beginning. 80 years ago, August 11th, 1944, It Pays to Be Ignorant. At least they custom did the music for covering the commercials. There you go, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We go from ignorance and satire to just satire. Stan Freberg is next.
Home shelters are your best protection from radioactive fallout. A basement shelter will offer good protection, but an underground shelter 3 feet below ground will give almost complete protection. It's your responsibility to decide which is the safest area in your home, then determine what needs to be done to give it the best possible protection. If you want to build a basement shelter with concrete or sandbagged walls and ceiling, plans are available. Remember, the moderate cost of constructing a shelter is low-cost insurance for you.
So the last time we heard from Stan Freberg, he was dealing with Miss Jupiter. Now, he's going to deal with a moon man. This episode of the Stan Freberg Show, 67 years ago, August 11th, 1957.
You know what that was?
What?
That was a full half hour of the Stan Freberg Show played backward at high speed. How would you like to hear it played forward at normal speed?
Please.
This is the fifth show of the series of a brand new radio series.
From Hollywood, we present the Stan Freberg Show.
With the music of Billy Mann.
Plus the songs of Peggy Taylor with Doris Butler, June Foray, Peter Leeds, and Judd Collins' Rhythm Airs.
You may not find us on your TV,
because in case you did not know, we're being brought to you one. Brought to you one. Brought to you one.
Good evening. Well, here it is, our fifth show already, and it's certainly been wonderful you folks to tune us in. You notice I didn't say invite us into your living room? We try to meticulously avoid saying that kind of radio cliche around here. We also try to avoid saying a funny thing happened to me on the way to the studio, or perhaps an old clock on the wall says it's time to go, or maybe, and now a word from our sponsor. On second thought, I'd rather enjoy saying that one. Any of you fellows out there in sponsor land who would enjoy having me say it, be sure and write, even if it's only a contract. Mr. Leeds, if you please, would you read the news bulletin?
Certainly, Stan.
Thank you.
From the wires of our news service, a brightly burning, unidentified object lit West Coast skies from Los Angeles to Portland, east to Salt Lake City in Boise, Idaho. Police at Yreka in far northern California near the Oregon border reported it appeared to be a small egg-shaped object which gave off blue sparks. A county sheriff's officer said hundreds of observers reported having seen a flying saucer.
Thank you. Now, I don't know how much stock you folks put in that story, but within a few hours of the time the object was sighted in the small town of Yreka, California, was it?
That's right, Yreka. Yep.
A flying saucer actually landed and was captured by Mr. Leroy Phipps.
Yep.
What was that again?
Yep. Oh.
Now, just how did you find the saucer, Mr. Phipps?
Well, I found it next to the carrots.
That again?
I come in for dinner. I was hungry. I sat down in the breakfast nook, and there it was, next to the carrots. Must have flown in the winter.
I see.
I thought it was an unusually large Hubbard squash.
Hubbard squash, eh? Well, how did you...
Well, I had it all buttered up. Yes, sir, I was going to partake of it. And then, all of a sudden, it started making a noise like a little teeny Dixieland band.
Well, I'll bet that pretty nigh scared you out of your boots.
No, I was not wearing boots.
No, I mean, were you alarmed?
Well, I thought it was an unusually musical Hubbard squash. I'd say that for it.
Mm-hmm. Well, what happened then?
Right after I thought it was an unusually musical Hubbard squash, you mean?
Yes.
Well, right after that, I'd given up eating supper.
Mm-hmm.
The lid popped open, and a teeny little man with antenna climbed right out.
Well, that's pretty fantastic. Just a moment, Mr. Phipps. So where's the saucer now?
What do you think this is I'm holding under my arm?
Well, I didn't know. Here, so set it on the table there.
All right.
Set it down. Gee, it's still buttered up.
Well, certainly. I ain't give up hope.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't see any man with an antenna.
Well, he was there.
Yeah, well, just a moment, Mr. Phipps.
Now, wait a minute. All right, you don't believe
me.
I'll go get my wife.
No need to bother your wife. Certainly is a strange-looking object. Wait a minute. It's starting to glow. What's this? Gentlemen, this is amazing. Bring that other microphone over here, please. Ladies and gentlemen, the saucer is now giving off rather blue sparks. Now a little door is opening. And a little man is coming out. I believe he's going to speak.
Take me to your leader.
No, that's the microphone. I'm over here.
Are you an Earth man?
Yes, I am. What did you think I was?
I don't know. I thought you were an unusually talkative Hubbard squash. You mind if I partake of you?
No, please. My name is Stan Freberg, actually. Where are you from?
My name is Orville. I'm from the moon. I got a letter from my sister. She was on your show 2 weeks ago.
Oh, yeah, Miss Jupiter, huh? The girl with the shapely wheels.
Sir, I'll thank you to leave my sister's wheels out of this.
I'm sorry, it was rude of me.
Do all the people here look like you?
Well, no, not all of them, no.
Because it's quite a disappointment to me so far, I'll be honest.
Well, I think we can fix that. Just a moment. Peggy Taylor, can you come over here a moment, please?
Why, sure, Stan.
You see there, Orville?
He's a nice-looking boy, isn't he?
Great.
I hadn't exactly thought of her like that. I must have a talk with you sometime, Orville. By the way, what made you decide to leave the moon?
Well, I didn't care for the climate. We had this stuff in the air. It was a kind of a mixture of smoke and fog. The politicians tried to blame it on the exhaust from the flying saucers. But, actually, it was caused by the green cheese refineries.
I see.
Oh, they kept promising to do something about it, you know, but they never did. Big business, you know. I got tired of my eyes burning and came here to Los Angeles to get away from it. Oh? You think I'll like it here better?
Well, I wouldn't send your laundry out for a while.
Hey, Freeb?
Yeah?
How about an introduction to the tomato?
Tomato? Where? Orville, that's a typewriter.
I'd like to see that in a bikini.
That's ridiculous.
Don't knock it if you haven't seen it.
I'd like to be on his show again sometime, Orville. You have a refreshing point of view.
I'd have to sell my saucer and move in with you. You think I could get a good price for it?
Oh, I think so.
It's nearly new. I bought it from a little old lady on Saturn who only drove it on Sundays. It's about 30 light years to the gallon, you know.
Well, perhaps we could sell it to a science fiction magazine.
Oh, come on. You don't believe that stuff, do you?
No, I don't believe that, John.
Neither do I. I'm going to sing.
I didn't know you did.
Come off it, Freeb. On the Interplanetary Network, I'm known as the voice of cheese.
I'm sorry, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I think I know that spaceman over there. Hey, Argog!
That's Billy May.
Sure looks like Argog. May I sing now? I have a song for my relatives back home.
Fine.
Hit it, Argog. Everybody on yon twinkling star, doesn't matter on which one you are. If you're digging me on your radar, hello out there, hello.
Take it, Freeb. Though you are a strange and weirdo race, if you are equipped to fly through space, pay a little visit to our place. Hello out there, hello. Take it, thank you.
If you got nothing else to do, just rev up the rocket. To pocket, to pocket. If you've a pair of wings that you attach to a sprocket, fly on down. Don't you let appearance worry you. They are pretty funny looking too. Anyway, in case I'm coming through, hello out there.
Last week, we had the pleasure of presenting Dr. Herman Horn, the noted electronics scientist, in the first of three lectures on hi-fi. Last week, we had such wonderful hi-fi demonstrations as the mating call of the aardvark, Luella Parsons putting catsup on a clam sandwich at the Brown Derby. Goodness knows what fascinating experience is in store for us tonight. And here he is, that man about electrons, Dr. Herman Horn.
Yes, thank you. By way of simple explanation to the layman, which is a polite way of saying cloth head, hi-fi brings out everything that is on the record. Little subtle things like piano overtones, harp vibrations, clicks, scratches, surface noise, all the things you couldn't hear before, and amplifies them with magnificent clarity. Yes. Hi-fi, of course, stands for high fidelity, and no home can be without it. In spite of what your wife says, ignore it. Ignore it. All women are troublemakers who would like to take the money their husbands need desperately for a new and better speaker and selfishly squander it on things like shoes for the children, homogenized milk, or perhaps a second dress. They can sit there and watch their husbands suffer with old equipment which has been obsolete for at least a week and deny him the new theater playback system he needs so badly. Shameful, shameful, Mrs. America. Comes now the contest. If you could guess the sound we are going to play, you win a life-size, full-color, inflatable latex rubber Liberace. He comes in a sitting position with arms extended, ready to be blown up and set down at your very own piano. Okay, Strudelmeier,
Blow him up.
Gee, that's realistic.
Well, certainly looks like Lee. Well, on with the contest. Here is an ordinary sound that you hear around the house every day. What is it? Give up. That was Benny Goodman in a skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, playing Danny Boy in a kelp bed. Too bad you missed. Well, try again. What is this? Well, you get it? That was King Farouk in a skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, applauding Benny Goodman. Comes now the last sound. Could you guess it? That was the sound of John L. Lewis giving his eyebrows a crew cut for the summer. Better luck next time. What a shame. Nobody won. All right, Strudelmeier, let the air out of the latex piano player. Right. Now, just a word about the care of hi-fi records. You've heard the expression, cleanliness is next to high fidelity? Well, all right. When you get home from the record store, wash the hands with surgical soap before removing the record from the plastic envelope. Rubber gloves and face mask are optional. Next, approach the machine on tippy-toe. You shouldn't raise no dust. To show you how good a sterile record sounds, my assistant, Strudelmeier, is going to play a dust-free, surgically clean LP that has never been touched by human hands. After he gets through with it, it still ain't been touched by human hand. From the edges, handle it only, Strud. Strudelmeier. It works better if you remove the plastic envelope first. That's a little better. Well, you did it that time, Strudelmeier. As you know, ladies and gentlemen, under the Hi-Fi Oath, Section 22, Paragraph 18, Strudelmeier must be destroyed at once. Get a big fire going under that oil, Strudelmeier. I want it boiling!
Unfortunately, we will not be able to continue with Dr. Horn's speech due to the fact that he seems to be cooking something on the stove. But he will be back again next week with more fascinating information on the subject of hi-fi.
Now for
Pardon me, Stan.
Oh, yes. What is it, June Foray, as they say in radio?
Do you mind if I go home now?
Well,
I don't have any other bits coming up.
I know, but I'd like to have you stick around. I mean, why do you have to dash off? Is this your bowling night?
No, that was last night. I want to get home and look at something.
You mean on that little box with the screen?
Yeah.
Sorry, you know the rules here in Radio June.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Come on, Stan. Let's deviate.
Well, if you insist. We just happen to have one of those things in my dressing room.
You do?
Shh, don't tell anybody. Come on.
Gee, I didn't know CBS Radio would allow one of those things, Miss B-Y-L-D-I-N-G.
Well, don't spread it around, huh?
Gee, a whole 10-inch set?
Yeah, I'll snap it on.
Gee, it sure is funny looking.
Yeah, I had it made up egg-shaped. CBS Radio just thinks it's an unusually pictorial Hubbard squash.
Well, believe me, I won't tell him. Hey, we're just in time for my favorite band leader.
You mean Bubbles? I think he's fading on now.
Good, I like him.
Thank you, and good evening, friends. We've been getting lots of cards and letters from you folks. From you folks out there in television land. And we surely do thank you for all the cards and the letters from you folks out there in television land. Starting us off tonight is our trio, the Lemon Sisters. And girls, so what are you going to sing?
We're going to sing Thank You for All Those Cards and Letters You Folks Out There in Television Land.
Lant.
Lant.
An apropos a number. One and a two and.
Thank you for all those cards and letters you folks in television land. We wonder where this television land is. Could it be a couple of miles from where?
Oh, it's the bubble machine. Turn off the bubble machine, please. Somebody. Folks. Just a moment. I'm sorry. Hold it just a moment, please. Turn off the bubble machine. Please, turn off the bubble. Thank you, Lemon Sisters, for that lovely number. Wonderful, wonderful. Now on the way to the show. There's that man with a deep, deep voice, Larry Looper. What are you going to sing for us, Larry?
I'm going to sing Thank You for All Those Cards and Letters.
I'm sorry that number has been taken.
Well, I'll sing the Funny Old Hills then.
Good. One and two and.
I'm happy on the prairie all the day, singing Lady Olay.
Lady Olay.
Funny old hill, sing back to me.
Hold it just a moment. No, hold it. Bubbles don't come till the end of the program. Please turn off the bubbles. Turn off. Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Larry Looper. And now I would like to play a short instrumental medley based on the names of the girls. A one, and a two, and. No. No, that's not it. That Thank you so very much. I hope you enjoyed that short instrumental medley. Now here's that young man about town, the front of the brass section, Stony Stonewell. To sing, please.
Please, lend your little ear to my plea.
Just a moment, please, hold it. Just a moment. If I don't count off the number, we can't hope to start off neatly. Here we go. A one and a two and... See how lovely that turned out now?
Please, lend your little ear to my plea. Lend the radiant ear to my plea. Tell me that you love me.
What is the matter with that machine? Just a moment, here. Hit it with your horn. That's got it. Thank you, Stony Stonewell. Now, hit it again. Hit it with the horn. Hit it. And stick your mouthpiece in it there. Hit it. A wonderful. Now, on the way to the show, woman. Here's our champagne lady, Alice Lean. What are you going to sing?
I am going to sing Wonderful, Wonderful, and now on with the show.
Ha-ha. That's just a little laugh on me. And I got a little laugh on you when you get your paycheck this week. Alice is going to sing Moonlight and Shadows. So one and two. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time in 25 years, my popping finger is caught in my cheek. Will you give me a hand, Alice? Pull on my arm. No, the other arm. That's it. Ow, my ears. A one and a two.
Moonlight and shadows, and you in my arms, and a melody in the bamboo tree, my sweet.
Everybody out. Just a minute. Somebody stop the bubble machine. The whole ballroom is filling with the bubbles. Where are you, Alice?
I'm shaving.
It figures. I can't see the cameras. Here, let me set the accordion down on the stage. And I'll try and fix that thing. Bear with us, folks. Just one moment, please. Gee, the time is running out and we haven't even played a polka. Hold it, boys. Just a minute. I didn't mean... Hold it, Alice. Don't polka on my accordion. Gee, Dad, it was a Wurlitzer. Hit the theme, boys. And so it's a good night from all the champagne. Where's the cameras? Music maker, turn off the bubble. Wonderful, wonderful. Take your foot out of my accordion, Al. And so, friends, help.
Stan Freberg Show is produced in Hollywood by Pete Barnum and is written by Stan Freberg and Pete Barnum with original songs by Stan Freberg. Featuring the music of Billy May, Judd Conlon, for the Mayors, and the songs of Peggy Taylor with Dawes Butler, Peter Leeds, and June Foray. Bud Sewell speaking.
Oh, people, people, do you know what next Sunday is?
No! What is next Sunday?
Next Sunday, we have set aside 1 minute as a time of universal tap dancing. At the given moment, people around the world will put aside their differences and tap dance side by side for 1 minute. At the given time, stop. Get out of your car, step out of your houses, wherever you are, and let's tap dance with our fellow man. If you can't tap dance, don't just sit there. Snap your fingers. Or at the very least, hum T for two. We'll have microphones. We'll have microphones set up around the world as each country joins in. That's a week from tonight as we set aside a time of universal tap dancing. Let this then be the first move toward international brotherhood. Until next week, this is Stan Freberg saying, brush up on those taps. God bless you for listening and good night.
Truly a crazy, crazy satirical show. The Stan Freberg Show, back on this day 67 years ago, August 11th, 1957. Tomorrow on Classic Radio Theater, we'll have Westerns and Crime with Gunsmoke, Fort Laramie, I Was a Communist for the FBI, Nick Carter, Master Detective, and Claudia. But up next, let's all go on a date with Judy.
Modern warfare is no respecter of people or places. Today, farms are right on the front line with the cities. Many of the same emergency items that will help take care of your family will also keep your farm producing. Stored fuels for farm equipment, emergency power, spare parts for farm machinery. Arrange for extra storage space for grains, eggs, dairy products, and other perishables. Everything you can produce will be needed. The nation's survival under attack will depend on how well you prepare now.
In the early part of her career, Joan Lorring was known as Dellie Ellis. And that's what you'll hear today. Joan Lorring, then still being billed as Dellie Ellis, in A Date with Judy. This goes back 82 years to August 11th, 1942, the summer replacement series for Bob Hope. Thus, it was Pepsodent sponsoring the show.
Pepsodent invites you to have A Date with Judy. Judy Foster, a typical American girl in a typical American family. Well, let's see. It's a quiet evening in the Foster house. Mother is sewing, father is reading, Randolph is tying Boy Scout knots, and Judy is glumping because she doesn't have a date. Mother looks up.
Melvin.
Yes, dear.
I had a letter from Grandma today.
You did, Mother? What'd she say?
She's worried about Aunt Lily.
Why is she worried about Aunt Lily?
Well, because
don't
she...
Don't tell me. Let me guess. Because Aunt Lily isn't married.
Well, yes.
Well, that's nothing new. Grandma's been worrying about that for the last 10 years.
I was just thinking, maybe we ought to have Lily here for a visit. A sweet girl like Lily.
Girl? Mother, she's 34 years old.
Well, really, Judy, that isn't the last stage of senility, you know.
They're girls to Mother till rigor mortis sets in.
I'm going to write Aunt Lily to come, and we'll see if we can't find somebody for her.
Maybe Judy could get her a date.
Me? I'm having enough trouble getting dates for myself. I haven't had a date for 3 nights.
Well, what are you complaining about? Aunt Lily hasn't had a date for 3 years.
That isn't so. I'm sure lots of young men have been extremely fond of Aunt Lily.
In 34 years, they've had lots of time to.
The problem is, how can we dig her up a man?
Digging him out might be a good idea.
Gee, come to think of it, I know somebody old enough for Aunt Lily.
Oh, who?
Mr. Manchester. He's a librarian at the library. I bet he's 35 if he's a day.
And he's a day, all right.
Why, that's a simply wonderful idea. But I wonder how we should go about asking him.
Well, I could kind of take a book out of the library and just sling the invitation to him.
We could invite him to dinner the very first night Aunt Lily's here.
Oh, sure. We wouldn't want to waste any time. After 34 leisurely years, we got a step on it.
That's only the beginning of your date with Judy, chaperoned by Pepsodent. How would you like to find out if your present toothpaste is really doing what you think it is? Maybe it's letting you down. Now, here's the way to find out. Run the tip of your tongue over your teeth. Can you feel a filmy coating? That's what makes teeth dingy, and it's a sign that you'd better switch to Pepsodent toothpaste tonight. Pepsodent with Irium is the new high-speed toothpaste with the fresh taste and the super-cleansing ingredients. It removes that dingy coating from teeth, makes them so brilliantly clean, they feel shiny smooth, and they look sparkling bright. So hunt up a collapsible metal tube from any product and take it to your drug counter tonight to exchange for a new tube of Pepsodent toothpaste. And now, back to A Date with Judy.
My goodness.
Hello, Lily. Well, it's certainly good to see you.
Do I get a kiss from my favorite brother-in-law?
You sure do, Lily.
Too bad, Father. He'd be perfect.
Well, I'm starved. When is that guy going to get here?
Guy? Dora, have you invited someone else to dinner?
Well, yes, in a way.
A man?
Well, yes, in a way.
Lily, you didn't have to. Now, Lily, this is just sort of an accident. As a matter of fact, we'd invited this gentleman to dinner long before we knew you were coming.
Oh, yes, eons before. I'll go. Now, I wonder who that could be.
good evening.
Oh, good evening, Mr. Manchester.
Very kind of you to stop at the library this afternoon. Invite me to dinner.
This afternoon? Oh, that's perfectly all right, Mr. Manchester. Come in. I'd like you to meet my, a friend of mine, Lily Rogan.
How do you do?
How do you do? And you know the rest of the family.
Oh, my, what a formal introduction. Suppose I do it all over. Lily, this is Donald. Donald, this is Lily.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Do people ever call you Don?
Oh, yes, indeed. At college, Ohio Wesley in 1924, they called me Don. Or Manchie.
Isn't that cute? Isn't that cute, Lily?
Yes, indeed.
Well, now that that's over, when are we going to have dinner?
My Aunt Lily cooked every inch of it, from soup to nuts.
Why, Randolph, I did not. Lily is so modest.
Well, how's business, Mr. Manchester?
Business?
Yeah.
Oh, very good. We collected 32 cents in fines today.
Oh, really?
Mr. Manchester is the new librarian, Lily. Lily is very interested in books, Mr. Manchester.
Oh?
She'd make a wonderful wife for somebody who was interested in literary things.
Judy!
My, that was a fine dinner, Mrs. Foster.
Thank you. Melvin, aren't you planning to go to your, lodge meeting tonight?
Why, no. My lodge meets on Thursdays.
Oh, well, the exalted high counselor called and said it was moved up to tonight. Early tonight.
Are you going out tonight, Mother, as if I didn't know?
Well, yes, I am. My Red Cross class meets tonight.
I thought that met on Fridays.
Well, during emergencies, they call special sessions.
Yes. Well, my goodness, I must say this isn't very sociable of us to run off like this, but... It will give you two a chance to get acquainted.
Oh, really, Dora, you don't have to do that.
Judy and Randolph are going out in the kitchen and wash the dishes. Aren't you dears?
Well, I guess we are. I guess.
And then they go right to bed, so you won't have to worry about them disturbing you. Well, come on, Melvin.
Thank you very much for the dinner, Mrs. Foster.
Oh, that's all right. Good night.
Night.
Good night.
Well, Dora, what are we going to do tonight?
What do you think we're going to do? You're going to take me to a movie.
Are they still in the living room?
Stay back here in the hall, Judy. I'll take a quick peek.
Are they?
Yeah. He's on one end of the Davenport and she's on the other.
Let me look. Gosh, she isn't turning on the heat, is she?
Personally, Mr. Manchester, I prefer Dickens' later works. Great Expectations always seemed to me a little, immature.
Jeepers, I'd never handle him that way.
My favorite work of Dickens is Nicholas Nickleby. Although I have found great charm in Pickwick Papers.
Me, I find no charm in this conversation.
Have you read much of Pope and Dryden?
Yes, I have.
Poor Aunt Lily. She doesn't know beans about men. She's a rank amateur.
Well, I wouldn't call either of them great lovers.
Don't you love the lilt of Pope's rhyme couplet?
Yes, I do.
Isn't that awful?
Hey, he's getting up. Maybe we'll see some action now.
Oh, my. It's 9:45. It's getting late.
Getting late?
It was charming meeting you, Mr. Manchester. I hope I'll see you soon.
I hope so, too.
This is the critical moment. If he asks her for a date now, she's in. Otherwise, she's cooked.
Good night, then.
Good night.
She's cooked.
What are you doing a week from tomorrow night, Miss Rogan?
Wednesday? Well, nothing.
He came through.
But a week from tomorrow night?
Yeah, I wouldn't exactly call it a whirlwind courtship.
I wonder if I might come to call.
Call?
He's one of those parlor plopsers.
Oh, I'd be very happy to see you.
Well, good night, then, Miss Rogan.
Good night, Mr. Manchester.
Well, he's gone. Yipes, at a one-a-week rate, it'll take her till Christmas.
You know, Randolph, I think I'll have to give her some advice about men.
You mean you're going to part with some of your vast store of knowledge on the subject?
If it helps her yoke a bloke, I'd be glad to.
Well, you've sure done enough research on the subject.
Aunt Lily, I hate to say this, but frankly, your technique is a little oogie.
There speaks the voice of experience.
Aunt Lily, tell me frankly, do you have a yen for Mr. Yanchester?
A yen? Oh, why, Judy, I hardly know the man.
What's that got to do with it? I asked you if you had a yen for him.
Well, I think he's very intelligent.
In Aunt Lily's language, that's a yen.
Look, Aunt Lily, one of the first principles of getting a guy gaga about you is to be glamorous in his eyes. Now, for instance, take Edgar.
Who's Edgar?
This guy I go with. He's gaga about me. Calls me up night and day. Now, the first thing I did when I wanted to make him wacky...
And he was that way to begin with, believe me.
Randolph, please. How can I give Aunt Lily any advice? Well, the first thing I did was find out what moving picture star was his ideal. Then I simply made myself look like that star, and there I was. His living ideal of glamour.
Do you always do that?
Well, sure. This week she's Dorothy L'Amour for Edgar, and a couple of weeks ago she was Lana Turner for Gerald.
Oh, for goodness sake.
Her Lana Turner's okay, but her Dorothy L'Amour is very nerve-wracking.
It is not, Randolph. Aunt Lily, I'll guarantee this will work.
Do you think so, Judy?
I'm positive.
Well, I'm not so sure, but... Well, give me the works.
Now, Andre, I want you to make Aunt Lily positively oomphy.
I will make her so oomphy it will hurt.
Good. You can start with a mud pack, and then an ice pack, and after the glacial, a facial, and then an eyebrow plump and an eyelash curl. This is not goo, Aunt Lily. It's perfectly terrific lipstick, isn't it, Andre?
Glamorola number 5, no less.
It's positively kiss-proof and everything.
Now, pucker up your lips, Aunt Lily.
And, Andre, when you finish the manicure, give her a pedicure.
The passion red nail polish on her feet, too?
Of course.
Oh, the passion red nail polish. He is so passionate.
Gee, Mitzi, what did Judy want us to come over here for?
Well, she said that something startling was going to emerge from the beauty shop. She wanted both of us to pass on it.
Well, here it comes.
Hello, Mitzi. Hi, Randolph.
Hello, Randolph.
Aunt Lily.
Aunt Lily, this is Mitzi. I asked her to drop by to, well, sort of give you the once-over.
Oh, really, Judy, do you have to call in perfect strangers?
Oh, Mitzi isn't a perfect stranger. She's my best girlfriend. Besides, she's practically an authority on glamour, aren't you, Mitzi?
Well, practically.
Doesn't Aunt Lily look perfectly yummy?
She sure does.
Me, I haven't been able to take my eyes off Aunt Lily since she came out of the beauty parlor. And I see a couple of pedestrians with the same idea.
I don't know whether they're staring at me or glaring at me. Let's go. Just wait till you get home and Mother sees you. She'll be insane about you.
And as for Father, they'll have to put him in an institution.
Gee, Aunt Lily, don't you feel just like a movie star?
Well, I certainly don't feel like myself.
I think you wow any man you meet, if you just remember to turn on the heat.
Turn on the heat?
That's what I've been trying to tell her, Mitzi. She means just give with the stuff, Aunt Lily. You know, quick on the trigger.
Give with the stuff?
It's really very easy. For instance, what repartee would you hand out if a man said to you, "Come on, Mouse, let's grouse"?
Well, no man I know would ever say, "Come on, Mouse, let's grouse."
You'd better listen to Mitzi, Aunt Lily. Her advice has been very successful with me. All I'm trying to do is make a cuddle cat out of you.
Well, I'm not so sure I want to be a cuddle cat.
Why, you do too, Aunt Lily. Go ahead, Mitzi. All right. Now, what do you come back with when somebody says to you, "What's cooking, good looking?"
Well, I don't know.
You come back with, "Soup, Droop."
I do.
Well, blow me down. Look who that is over there across the street.
Why, it's Mr. Manchester. Oh, my.
Why, Aunt Lily, under that glamour of number 5, you're blushing.
He's coming over to talk to us. Now, remember, Aunt Lily, sparkle. Be enthusiastic. Act hip.
Do I look all right? You look like a house afire.
That's what I'm afraid of.
Do you want to make a positive impression on this guy, Miss Rogan?
Oh, yes. Yes, I do.
Then hand out the goo. Do like Mitzi says. Talk about his necktie and his shoulders and his chest expansion.
Well, I'll try. Oh, here he comes.
Oh, Miss Rogan.
Oh, dear.
Miss Rogan.
Good luck, Aunt Lily.
Good afternoon, Miss Rogan. And hello, children.
Hello.
Hi, Mitzi.
Why, Miss Rogan.
What's cooking? Good looking.
I beg pardon?
That's a very beautiful necktie you have on. And so are your shoulders.
What was that, Miss Rogan?
And you've got a very snazzy chest expansion.
Why, Miss Rogan?
When are you coming over to dinner again, Mr. Manchester?
Why, I don't know.
You know what we're having for dinner tonight?
Well, no, I'm...
We're having soup, Drew.
Well, oh, my goodness.
You're doing fine, Miss Rogan.
Would you like to come to dinner tonight, Mr. Manchester?
Well, I hardly think I can make it. Well...
You can come over and grouse, Mouse.
Well, some other time, perhaps.
Oh, but Mr. Manchester...
Well, the fact is, I have a library committee meeting tonight, and I must attend. I'm dreadfully sorry.
I'll see you next Wednesday, then.
Well, I'm not absolutely sure that I can make it. That is... I'll have to let you know. Well, I'm very glad I saw you. I'm sorry I have to dash.
Goodbye, Mr. Manchester.
Goodbye. I really have to dash.
Well, that certainly was a dashing conversation.
I can't understand it. You were just wonderful, Aunt Lily.
Yes. You certainly sparkled and everything.
Yes, I sparkled all right. Sparkled him right out of my life.
Well, he certainly did have a funny reaction.
Oh, well, Aunt Lily, don't bother about him. If he has funny reactions like that, I just wouldn't waste any time on him.
I certainly wouldn't. He acted like an ick.
He did not. He's a sweet, sensible man, and I like him very much.
Jeepers, I never thought love would enter into this.
Well, Judy and Randolph seem to be doing it the hard way. We'll see what happens on your date with Judy in just a moment. You know, there's a hard way and an easy way to do everything. The hard way to learn if your teeth are dingy, if your smile is unattractive, is to watch the reaction of your friends. If they seem to avoid you, that may be a clue. The easy way to learn about your smile takes 2 seconds and spares you lots of embarrassment. Now, here's all you do. Run the tip of your tongue over your teeth. Feel that filmy coating? That dingy film collects stains on your teeth, spoils the effect of your smile, and there's no reason in the world why you should put up with it. For Pepsodent toothpaste removes that filmy coating you can feel with your tongue. Pepsodent with Irium is a clean-tasting toothpaste with super-cleansing ingredients. It foams through your mouth in millions of refreshing bubbles that loosen and flush away the dingy film from your teeth. When you brush your teeth with Pepsodent, they're so clean they pass the tongue test. They feel clean, and they look so sparkling and shiny, everybody likes to see you smile. Tomorrow may be your big day, so go to your drug counter tonight and say, Pepsodent toothpaste, please. And remember to take an empty tube, any size from any product, to exchange for your new tube of Pepsodent. Well, let's see what's happening now on Your Date with Judy.
Randolph, I feel terrible. Aunt Lily's been practically in tears ever since we got home. She's practically ruining her makeup.
Well, to me, she looks better with it ruined.
You know, Randolph, I think she goes for Mr. Manchester.
Well, she'll never marry him if we keep helping her.
You know what I'm going to do, Randolph?
I hate to think.
I'm going to offer her Edgar.
Edgar? What's she going to do with him?
Well, haven't you ever heard of the Eternal Triangle? When Mr. Manchester hears Aunt Lily's going out with Edgar, well, you know what we'll have?
What?
Jealousy. I'm calling Edgar right now.
Hello?
Hello, is that you, Edgar?
Yeah, what do you want, Judy?
How would you like to have a date?
Huh?
Isn't this a slight reversal of form?
Oh, sure, Judy, anytime you say.
How about tonight?
Swell, when do I pick you up?
Oh, the date's not with me. It's with a new girl who just came to town.
A terribly new girl, just 34 years old.
Be quiet, Randolph. Is it a date, Edgar?
Hey, what are you trying to pass off on me? Some witch?
Why, Edgar, what a way to talk. This girl's just about the cutest number you ever saw.
All right, what's the matter with her?
Nothing. She's very young and very attractive.
And hasn't had a date for 6 years.
Randolph. Edgar, will you do this for me?
Well... all right. I'll do it if you'll promise to go with me to the summer prom.
It's a date. Now come right over and pick up Aunt Lily.
Aunt Lily? Okay, Judy. I'll be right over.
He's going to do it.
Aunt Lily? Aunt Lily?
Yes, Judy?
Aunt Lily, I've got your date with a new man.
I don't want a date with a new man.
Why, Aunt Lily, don't be silly. You didn't want a date with Mr. Manchester, and just look how he turned out.
Yeah, just look.
Now, Aunt Lily, it's absolutely imperative you impress Edgar, because then you'll get dates with other boys. And the first thing you know, it'll get back to Mr. Manchester. You're chasing around with everybody.
Will that be good?
He'll be eaten up. Now, look, Aunt Lily, we've got to rebuild your personality entirely.
Again? Oh, no.
We're going to rehearse. Randolph, you're Edgar.
I'm who?
You pretend you're dating Aunt Lily.
Well, okay. I'm in the Edgar mood. And here I come, ready or not.
Judy, somehow my heart isn't in this.
Remember, it's all for Mr. Manchester.
Well,
Randolph?
Why, my dear Miss Rogan, it's a pleasure to see you again. May I kiss your hand?
Randolph, you know Edgar doesn't talk like that. You don't have to be so Shakespearean.
Oh, excuse me. It's the Manchester influence. Okay, I'll start over. Hiya, goon, let's spoon.
That's too abrupt, Randolph. It's too abrupt, don't you understand? Try it again. Oh, dear, that must be it, sir. We haven't had time to rehearse.
Oh, it really doesn't make much difference, Judy.
Hello, Edgar.
Hiya, Judy.
Edgar, I want you to meet your date, Aunt Lily. Aunt Lily, this is Edgar. Edgar, this is Miss Rogan.
How do you do?
How do you do? It is a pleasure to meet you.
Gee, he's positively Shakespearean.
Goofers, what are you doing over at my house so early in the morning?
I couldn't sleep, so I just thought I'd come over.
Did you have a nice time with Aunt Lily last night?
Judy, I gotta talk to you.
Well, of course, go ahead.
Judy, I'm bats about her.
Oh,
Lily.
Aunt Lily?
Don't keep calling her Aunt Lily. She's hardly any older than you are.
Why, Edgar Wilson, she's twice my age. And yours, too.
That's just it. She's so mature.
I'm... Edgar Wilson, have you got a crush on Aunt Lily?
Don't call it a crush. That sounds so, well, childish. And Lily's so, well, spiritual and womanly and everything. Judy, I'm going to ask you something.
What?
Do you think I have a right to ask Lily to wait for me?
Wait for you?
Well, yeah, just until I finish high school.
Edgar, you're out of your mind.
No, I'm not. A lot of men have married older women. Why, when I'm 60, she'll only be 77. And gee whiz, when you're 77.
Oh, Bugs, I never thought this would happen.
Judy, would you mind just awfully if I took Lily to the summer prom instead of you?
Oh, characters.
May I see Lily, please?
She's still sleeping. Do you want me to wake her?
Oh, no, no, no. I wouldn't disturb her sylvan dreams for anything. I'll come back later. Bye, Judy. Oh, Lily Bell. Oh, Lily Bell.
This is Graham. Randolph! Randolph, come here. I need you.
What's the matter now, Miss Fairfax?
The triangle just backfired. Edgar is gaga about Aunt Lily.
Now I have seen everything.
And me. I'm just positively gaga about Edgar. Oh, Randolph, I'm desperate. Aunt Lily's in grave danger.
Of what? Being robbed by the cradle?
We best do something for our own blood relation, Aunt.
Sweet, unselfish little Judy. Of course you aren't worried about holding Edgar or anything.
Randolph, don't quibble. What'll we do?
Well, let me put my brain to it. I'll think of something. Now, don't be so desperate, Judy. You'll get your man back.
Hey, if Edgar had married Aunt Lily, he'd be my uncle.
Well, like I've been telling you, Mr. Manchester...
Hush, no loud talking in the library, Randolph.
Well, what I've been trying to tell you is that my Aunt Lily's been running around with another man.
She has?
Yeah, he's practically on the verge of almost proposing to her.
Hush, he is?
Yeah, it's one of those whirlwind courtships. He's got her practically swept off her feet.
Hush, oh, that's terrible.
He likes her because she's so simple and intellectual and everything. You know that day we saw you in the street? She was just made up that way because she was going to a masquerade.
Hush, a masquerade? I never thought of that.
Yeah, she was going as Judy. Everybody had to go with something funny. You heard her practicing talking like Judy?
Yes, I did. A masquerade. Well, that's wonderful news.
Of course. Now, if you move fast, you may still be in time to stop the elopement. There may be a ladder outside of her window this very moment.
Randolph, I'm going to move faster than I've ever moved in all my life.
Mr. Manchester, hush.
Where is she?
Why, good afternoon, Mr. Manchester.
Where is she?
Where's who?
Lily, of course.
Well, I guess she's upstairs in her room.
Oh, quick, before she escapes.
Mr. Manchester, are you going upstairs?
We've got to stop that elopement.
Oh, yes, of course. Elopement?
There may be a stepladder outside her window this very moment.
Well, if there is, this is the first I've heard of it.
Lily! Lily! Where are you, Lily?
Who's doing all that yelling?
Mother, what's happening around here?
I don't know. Mr. Manchester just ran upstairs like a crazy man.
I wonder what made him do that.
Gee, I hope he doesn't see Aunt Lily. She isn't a bit hep or glamorous today. She's just herself again.
Oh, that same old personality she used to have.
I found her.
Don't.
I've got her.
Don't.
Hey, look at him. He's holding Aunt Lily downstairs like a cave.
Put me down, Donald. Put me down.
He likes it.
I want to say something, Lily. I want to say it right here in front of everybody. Don't do it, Lily.
Do what?
I can't imagine.
Lily, call off that elopement.
Why, Lily, what's been going on in this house?
Oh, I wouldn't know.
I'll make you a devoted husband, even though my courtship hasn't been whirlwind.
Sounds mighty whirlwind to me.
Blows me completely over.
Donald. Donald, are you proposing?
Well, I guess I am.
Take him up on it quick, Aunt Lily. All right. I accept you, Donald.
Gee, they're engaged.
Just as soon as I get my breath, I'll congratulate you.
Lily, I think I'm going to kiss you.
Oh, not here, Donald.
Oh,
go ahead, Aunt Lily. It's fun.
Children, I just got another letter from Grandma.
What'd she say?
Well, let me see. She says, I'm very happy to hear about Lily's engagement, and... Oh, good heavens.
What's the matter, Mother?
She's sending Aunt Gertrude and Cousin Georgiana to visit us. She wants us to get them married, too.
Yeah.
You have just heard A Date with Judy, the story of an American family. Let's join the Foster family again for a moment.
Gee, Mother, I had a good week.
You did, dear?
Yes, I had 5 dates. One with Oogie, and one with Hank, and one with Skunky, and...
Answer the door, Randolph.
Yes, Mother.
Within 20 minutes after the receipt of this order for deportation, you, together with the members of all your family, should be ready for departure and wait in the street outside your house. You may take with you 1 set of clothing, 1 wooden woolen blanket per person, food for several days, birth certificate, not more than $20.
Other fantastic? No, not at all. Hundreds of thousands of Dutch, Belgians, Poles, French have heard that order read. It is being read this very minute in some black corner of Europe. People are victims. Always the quiet, innocent people like you. Old and young, women with babies in their arms. And it can happen here.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, it can happen here. Unless we stamp it out over there. And that means guns and tanks and planes. Not only more than the enemy has. Not air supremacy, but air and ground mastery. That takes money. Every day, every hour. More planes must be built. More guns made. More tanks manufactured.
That's right, Dora. Buying a few bonds isn't enough. We must buy bonds regularly so we can make the engines of war without stopping. Every quarter we invest in war bonds sends 12 bullets ripping into Axis tank columns. Every dollar we invest turns our war wheels faster, grinds our enemies smaller. That's why our government urges us to put at least 10% of our earnings into war bonds. That's why millions of Americans have already joined the 10% club by buying war bonds regularly every payday. The best way to safeguard our future is to destroy completely everything the Axis stands for, with bullets, with planes, with tanks. And it'll take money. 10% of it every payday to do the job.
My dad's a member of the 10% club, aren't you, Dad?
That's right, Randolph. Because we know that every day, every dime counts in lives and blood. We hope you buy your quarter of war bonds tomorrow.
A Date with Judy came to you from Hollywood. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
That war bond plug took him right out of time, didn't it? August 11th, 1942, 82 years ago today, A Date with Judy here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Tomorrow, Westerns with Gunsmoke and Fort Laramie. Crime with I Was a Communist with the FBI and Nick Carter, Master Detective. And we'll wrap it all up with Claudia. Speaking of crime, it's a crime how Monty Woolley acts in this, The Magnificent Montague from 73 years ago.
Power failure, doing without gas or electric service, is something we've all experienced at one time or another. But in time of disaster due to natural causes or enemy attack, we might have to do without such service for a long time. With refrigerated foods, this can be serious. If power is out for more than 12 hours, eat or cook the most perishable items in your refrigerator before they spoil. If you can't cook them, throw them out. Persons who own freezers should consult their service books. Remember, when power fails, keep your refrigerators and freezers closed.
I know somebody will get mad at me for that crack, but it was the only segue I had. Monty Woolley as the Magnificent Montague, going back 73 years to August 11th, 1951.
The Magnificent Montague, starring Monty Woolley. Yes, it's The Magnificent Montague, the Saturday night transcribed feature on NBC's All-Star Festival of Comedy, Music, Mystery, and Drama. Brought to you by Anacin, for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. By RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, and first in television. And by Chesterfield, always milder, better tasting, cooler smoking, plus no unpleasant aftertaste. Before we hear from the Magnificent Montague, let's hear from Anacin. When we ask you to try Anacin for the relief of pain due to a headache, neuritis, or neuralgia, we are not asking you to try a new or unproved method. For there are many people listening in now who have been introduced to Anacin tablets by their own dentist or physician. You who have received Anacin this way know the effective, incredibly fast relief these tablets bring. Anacin is like a doctor's prescription. That is, Anacin contains not just one, but a combination of medically proven active ingredients in easy-to-take tablet form. People by the thousands are using modern Anacin today instead of other ways. Doesn't their experience seem worth following? Try Anacin the next time you suffer from pains of headache, neuritis, or neuralgia. You will be delighted with the results. Ask your druggist for Anacin today. Anacin is spelled A-N-A-C-I-N. And now, the Magnificent Montague. Since Edwin the Magnificent Montague retired as undisputed and unemployed champion of the Shakespearean stage and became Uncle Goodheart, hero of an afternoon radio program, his only dramatic outlets are confined to daily arguments with Agnes the Montague maid. It is afternoon. Montague's wife, Lily, and Agnes await his arrival from the radio station. The telephone rings.
Agnes, the telephone.
You get it, honey. I'm in the kitchen, up to my knees in hamburger.
All right, Agnes.
Hello? Who? I'm sure you have the wrong number. There's no one here by the name of Everlasting Love.
Hold it, honey.
Agnes, it's the wrong number. Somebody wants someone called Everlasting Love.
Give me the phone. That's me.
Everlasting Love?
I'll explain later. Hello? Everlasting on this end. Who's calling? Oh, it's you, Pleasant Valley.
Pleasant Valley?
That's Tilly Kleinholt.
Tilly?
Shh, I'll explain later. Hello, Pleasant Valley? What's up, kid? Oh, big meeting tonight, huh? What's on, nocturnal meditations or one of them love-through-deep-breathing sessions?
Agnes, what is...
I'll explain later. Okay, Pleasant, see you at the meditating. Yeah.
Agnes, what's going on?
It's my club, the Unattached Girls of East 37th Street. We all join a new cult.
What?
The cult of Shamgar Abishmu Yu.
What's that mean?
Life through living.
Life through living?
Yeah, it comes from India. It was brought over here by our leader, our exalted one, the Great Benaru.
The Great Benaru?
He's slipping us the secrets of life. I tell you, honey, he's done more for the girls. I tell you, honey, he's done more for the girls of our club than Match Factor.
Well, what's it all about?
Who knows? It has something to do with developing our inner beauty.
Your inner beauty?
What can we lose? We got none of it on the outside.
Oh, Agnes, you're being silly.
Honey, you know, you ought to come to one of our meetings at the Temple of Beauty.
A temple?
Yeah. Well, it's our temporary temple. It's in a loft on 10th Avenue. We're raising funds for our real temple, one of them oriental things, a mosque.
You mean a mosque?
Mosque, mosque. What's the difference as long as the roof comes to a point?
Well, Agnes, what do you do at the temple?
Honey, it's out of this world. The incense is going, the great Benaru spouting words of wisdom. We're sashaying around our sheets, practicing breathing. It's a real ball.
You mean you dress as they do in India?
Yeah, sandals and veils. Chubby Kretlow showed up with belt on her feet.
Just like Indian dancing?
Yeah. Kids kept running up to her. With that white sheet and the belt, they thought she was a good humor truck.
Oh, Agnes.
Edna Schissel really went to town. She showed up at the tent with a big red ruby in her nose.
Oh, no.
Yeah, right in her schnoz. On the way home, she was standing on a corner and stopped traffic for half an hour.
A half an hour?
They were waiting for her nose to change to green.
Oh, you girls have loads of fun.
Honey, this is serious stuff. We're learning how to live. For the first time in my life, I'm at peace with myself. My heart's full of love for man or beast.
Man or beast?
Yeah, that even includes your husband.
Oh, Agnes, if this means that after 25 years, you and Edwin will start getting along with each other, I'm glad you joined.
Hey, why don't you join, honey? For every new member I bring in, I get my sheet washed free.
Oh, I'll have to see how it works out. I just can't imagine you and Edwin not bickering.
Honey, thanks to the teachings of our exalted leader, the great Benaru, I can just float to a higher mental plane above the petty fights with that monster.
Well, start floating, Agnes. That's Edwin.
I'll get the door.
Oh, Edwin.
Hello, Lily.
Welcome home, Mr. Montague.
Who said that?
Agnes said it.
Our Agnes, our own little big mouth Agnes, said welcome.
She wants to be friendly.
Welcome. She makes it sound like a dirty word.
don't start with her. You're in for a big surprise.
I know, and what a surprise.
Well, then you know about it.
Yes, the mayor's office reached me at the radio station and told me all about it.
The mayor's office?
Yes, that I was made a member of the mayor's anti-crime committee.
Oh, Edwin, that's wonderful. It must be because of the good influence your Uncle Goodhart radio program has on the public.
Do you realize the people of this city are milked out of $50 million a year by con men, charlatans, and other frauds? We're going to clean them all out.
Good for you, Edwin. To celebrate, Agnes will make us a nice dinner.
Yeah, I'll make anything you want. What would you like?
Someone else to cook it.
Why, you dirty...
Agnes?
Ish, miri, bamba, bambarish.
Who said that?
It's Agnes.
Agnes? Ish, miri, bambambarish? Oh, gad, Saroyan wrote a new song. It'd be bigger than Come On a High House.
Ishmiri bambamarish. May my mind be cleansed of anger and may my heart and hand be dedicated to bringing peace and happiness to my master's house.
Lily, call a doctor.
Edwin.
Her mind is snapped. She must have had a horrible shock.
Please.
Remember, the same thing happened to her once before when Francis X. Bushman got married.
Oh, stop that. Edwin, look at her. Can't you see Agnes is on a higher plane?
A higher plane?
Edwin, try and understand. Agnes has found something new. She's floating in a world of her own.
Oh, no. Agnes? Agnes, I'm on the crime committee. I can help you. Tell me, Agnes, who sold you the stuff?
Edwin, don't be ridiculous.
Ridiculous? She didn't get that way on Ovaltine.
May the seed of wisdom blossom in your brain, dear master, so that you too may rejoice in the garden of life.
The garden of life. I told you, Lily, she's growing it in the backyard.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
Lily, we must wipe out these peddlers who look for weak-minded people, and in Agnes, they hit the jackpot.
That does it.
Now, Agnes.
Stand back, honey. I'm coming down from my higher plane.
Now, look, Agnes.
Weak-minded, huh?
Agnes.
Now, listen, you overstuffed baboon. You better zip those liver lips of yours closed before I take your beard and shove it down your throat. No.
Edwin, I've been trying to tell you. Agnes and the girls of her club have joined a new cult.
Oh, no. What is it this time?
We're followers of the Great Benaru.
Good. What band does he sing with?
Edwin, it's one of those philosophies of life from India.
Shangha Abhishmu Yu. It's the teachings of our great leader, Benaru, brought from Mother India.
Agnes?
Yes?
Tell me more, Agnes. I'm quite interested in this new cult of yours. Tell me, can anyone join?
Oh, anyone. All you need is joy in your heart, an open mind, and a sawbuck.
$10. That's all.
From then on, it's only $5 a week. That pays for the rent of the temple, the incense, and a down payment on your tambourine.
$10 initiation fee, $5 a week. Sounds like someone's onto a good thing.
It certainly is, Mr. Montague. If you're interested, here's a pamphlet.
Well, thank you, Agnes. I am very interested.
Oh, boy, Mr. Montague, if you join, we could do our meditations and deep breathing together.
Fine, Agnes. Now, run along.
Ankara Tamura. In peace, the little lamb will lie down with a jackass.
Edwin, are you serious?
Serious? I've never been more serious in my life. This is a matter for my anti-crime committee, the Great Benaru. It's crooks like him who have been jipping the public.
Oh, now, Edwin, don't go off on one of your crusades again.
Lily, you forget I'm on the mayor's anti-crime committee. It's my duty to expose this phony.
But the newspapers won't print anything unless you have proof.
Newspapers? Who needs them? Remember, I am Uncle Goodhart. I have 10 million radio listeners. I'll blast this Benaru right out of...
Oh, that's the door. I'll get it. Oh, hello, Mrs. Enzer.
Hello, Mrs. Montague. Is Uncle Goodhart home?
Well, Edwin, it's Mrs. Enzer, the director of your radio program.
Enzer, tomorrow's Uncle Goodhart program is going to make radio history.
Yeah, it sure is. I got the script here for you. It's a humdinger.
The script?
Remember how this afternoon's episode ended? You were cleaning little Oscar at your canary's cage. But you had left the room to get a clean newspaper... And when you came back, Oscar was gone.
Yes, thank heaven.
We went up there.
Tomorrow I will arouse America. The citizens, the police, the FBI will join forces with me.
Looking for little Oscar?
Oscar, that's out.
On tomorrow's program, I am going to destroy one of the most horrible fiends this country has ever known.
I know. The mean old pussycat who frightened Oscar away.
Oh, no, Zinza. I'm talking about the Great Benaru.
No, the cat's name is Poo Poo.
I'm trying to tell you. I'm going to show the housewives how a big phony like Benaru can take advantage of them.
Oh, no. The sponsor wants no controversial material.
Nonsense. Go, Zinza. Tell him tomorrow Uncle Goodheart blasts the Great Benaru out of existence.
Oh, dear. Here we go again.
Edwin, the sponsor's right. You can't say things like that on the program without proof.
I'm going to get the proof. Where's that pamphlet? Oh, let's see. The Temple of Beauty, 10th Avenue. Where's my hat?
Wait, but where are you going?
To the Temple of Beauty. Wait till you see what happens when the Great Benaru meets the Magnificent Montague.
We'll be back to see what happens when the Magnificent Montague meets the Great Benaru in just a moment. Now here's April Stevens for RCA Victor.
Please play that dreamy melody, the one you played for me last night. That lovely dreamy melody, remember how we danced last night.
Dreamy Melody, sung by sultry April Stevens with Henri René's orchestra, is a scorching follow-up to their terrific RCA Victor release, I'm in Love Again. Now, Dreamy Melody, with soft lyrics and a beautifully scored backing, is due to skyrocket to the top. Two big hits are back-to-back on this single RCA Victor record. Coupled with Dreamy Melody is April Stevens' smoldering Gimme a Little Kiss, Will You, Huh? Available now on RCA Victor Records. And now, the Magnificent Montague. With all the cunning of an ace investigator, Montague prepares to unmask the Great Benaru. He has reached the office building which houses the Temple of Beauty, headquarters of Benaru's mystic cult.
Dad, what a crummy building. Let's see, Temple of Beauty. Here's the room. 107. Gad, look at that door. Just a big eye, all staring at you. Just a peephole in the middle. What a slimy setup. I'll knock.
Who knocks at the temple gate?
It is I, a weary stranger who seeks truth at the feet of the Great Benaru.
Come in, weary stranger.
Gad, it's dark in here. Are you Benaru?
I am Ganga, the humble servant of the exalted leader.
Oh.
The great one is meditating in the inner temple. Whom shall I say wants to see him?
Well, Doe, John Doe.
This way to the inner temple. Watch out for the water cooler. Go here.
Phew, this incense.
Silence. Ish can do Abu Karim. Almighty One, a neophyte stands before you. Speak, exalted one.
Who is it that seeks solace and peace through the ancient teachings of Shangar Bishmuyu?
It is I, a weary traveler on the highway of life, John Doe.
And what is your wish, weary traveler?
I wish to be a disciple of the great Benaru.
Are you ready to answer the mystic question of Ishmir?
I am ready.
Ibu Hassan Kahula Murabula. Has our gracious and beloved neophyte a bank account, negotiable bonds, real estate, or an automobile free and clear?
Are you solvent?
Well, I'm very well off.
He's in.
Ishmir, leader of our destinies, you have smiled upon us this day. You have sent to us this weary traveler, this lost lamb, this little pigeon. We shall take his soiled soul and clean him. Faithful Ganga, have him sign the Book of Ishmael.
Right here. That's for the dues. $25 a week.
25? Well, Agnes, I mean, everlasting love only pays 5, almighty one.
She is young. You are an older man, and there is so much more to clean. Ganga, get him ready.
Step over to the light. I got to measure you for a sheet. That's another $5.
A sheet, eh?
It better take 2. Give him a Book of Ishmael.
Check.
A tambourine to gladden Ishmael.
Check.
A year's supply of goat milk, yogurt, dates, nuts, and a Great Benaru patented garlic juice extractor.
Check. That comes to $200.
Check.
No check. Cash.
Cash, eh? Why, you miserable faker.
Silence.
You're speaking to the mighty one.
Yes, the mighty fraud. You fleeced your last lamb, Benaru. As a member of the mayor's crime investigating committee, I'm exposing you for what you are, a snake in the grass.
Why, you...
Silence, Ganga. Do not touch him. Leave me alone with this disbeliever.
Yes, mighty one.
Benaru, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, preying on innocent people with this lostness cult.
Ashamed of myself, Mr. Doe? Because it is necessary to collect a few paltry pennies in order to build a temple, a shrine where rich and poor can come and learn the teachings of Ishmael. For this, I am to be persecuted?
The great Benaru, you're wasting your time. I know who you are and what you are.
And I know who you are.
You know who I am?
Would I ever mistake that voice? The one voice in this confused land that offers comfort and solace to the millions in the wilderness. The voice of Uncle Goodheart.
Oh, you listen to my program?
Every afternoon. It is part of our ritual.
It is?
When you are on the air, the temple bells are still. Everything stops. Not a tambourine is stepped. Not a sheet stirs. Not a goat is missed.
I don't understand.
The good are often so blind. You, Mr. Montague, are 1 in 10 million. You, Mr. Montague, you have inner beauty.
Really?
Who but a man with inner beauty could show such love and compassion as you to your little canary, Oscar? I know all the age-old secrets of life, but you, Mr. Montague, you know something no one else in the whole world knows.
What is that?
What happened to little Oscar?
Good morning, Agnes. It's breakfast. Agnes, you're purple.
I'm doing my morning breathing meditations. I got one more to do.
Oh, I'm glad Edwin is going to expose your great Benaru. After Edwin's broadcast, the great Benaru won't get...
That's the door.
Oh, never mind. I'll get it, Agnes.
Edwin Montague live here?
Yes.
This is for him. Sign here.
There. What is it?
A case of goat's milk.
Wait. There must be some Miss Agnes. Goat's milk.
Same brand I use. Nanny's Nectar.
Oh, I get it. It's Benaru's idea of insulting Edwin. Now, wait till Edwin hears of this. I'd better get him up. He has a broadcast to do. Edwin, it's time to get up.
Oh. What's the matter, Lily? Haven't you ever seen a man standing on his head before?
Mr. Montague, do you mean...
Ishambura, little sister. Ishambura.
Ishambura, brother, and I do mean Ishambura.
Edwin, this is fantastic.
He is a paragon, Lily. A great man. I have a new purpose in life. Raising money for the great Benaru.
Oh, Edwin.
Oh, we asked little enough. A few pennies to pay for the great Benaru's trip to India.
The great bee's going to India?
Yes, everlasting love. Our leader must go to the mother country for his year of meditation and solitude.
Oh, so that's why we're going out in the street making collections today. We all got tin cups.
I, too, in a tattered sheet, will go out to begging for alms for our leader.
I'm going to be in front of the Paramount. Where are you stationed?
I'm waiting around the fountain at Rockefeller Center.
Ed, begging in the street. Are you out of your mind? You have a broadcast to do. Remember, you're going to blast Benaru.
Please, Lily, my 10 million listeners will share with me my inner joy. My 10 million listeners. That's the answer.
What?
You were right, Lily. I should not beg for pennies on the street. I will beg from my listeners.
Edwin, you can.
Silence! Hand me my sheet. I am off to the studio.
Where's Montague? It's almost time to go on the air.
Oh, dear, and such an important broadcast, too.
Where is he? We've only got a... Oh, here he comes.
Oh, goody.
Sorry I'm late, brother. Ishma osh kabuchka.
Gesundheit.
Good news, Mr. Montague. The sponsor is 100% behind your expose of the Great Benaru.
Go get him, Mr. Montague.
Silence. Little Oscar, my canary, is lost. The world is waiting to find out what happened to him.
Who cares about little Oscar?
That crummy bird.
That is unkind. Oh, that is unkind, Brother Zinzer. A canary, too, is a living creature.
Mr. Montague, you must go through with it. The sponsor... Oh, jeepers, we're on the air.
Bluegill Soap, that soapier soap, presents... Uncle Goodheart. And here he is with special message packed with dynamite, public citizen number one, that fighting radio character, Uncle Goodheart.
Once again, I am with you, dear brothers and sisters of Radioland. A great man, my teacher, the great Benaru, sits in sadness today. He has no money with which to return to his native land, India, for his year of meditation.
Mr. Montague!
Peace, brother. I know that in your cookie jars you have some money saved up. Whatever it is, send it to the great Benaru, care of the Temple of Beauty.
Stop him!
Peace, brother. A dollar, a dime, anything.
Grab him, Springer!
Unhand me, brother.
Ladies and gentlemen, soliciting contributions over the air are illegal, and any ideas expressed by Uncle Goodheart are not those of the sponsor. The sponsor sponsors no sponsored ideas. Please excuse music.
They took us off the air. Mr. Montague, have you gone nuts?
He must have snapped his cap.
Oh, please, brother.
You can't promote a phony thing like that on the air. Hello? What? Oh, no. That was the Federal Communications Commission. They're on their way over.
Hello? Yikes.
Who was it?
The FBI. I think I'm going to faint.
Mr. Montague, do you realize what's happening? They'll shut down the network. We'll be barred from the air. They'll close down Frugal Soap. Heads will roll.
Brothers, you have nothing to worry about. Ish kababa. May you live and prosper.
I'm going to kill myself.
Day, Ganga, peaceful day.
Come in quick.
Where is our great leader? Oh, there you are, exalted one, pride of Ishmir. Your troubles are over.
My troubles are just beginning, you big jerk.
But leader...
Shut up and help me pack.
You're off to India, beloved one?
India? I'll be lucky if I get as far as the Holland Tunnel.
But my broadcast...
You and your big mouth. In every racket I worked, I was careful not to run into a federal rap. So you open that big bazoo, it goes all over the country, and I'm hung up with a federal case.
Wash the car out the back
door, Casey.
It's too late.
I shall call upon the spirit of Ishmael for help.
Forget Ishmael. Call me a good lawyer.
Are, Edwin.
Hello, Lily.
Has Asha Benur. Greetings, peaceful night.
Greetings, sister.
Edwin, what's happened? The phone's been ringing all day.
Oh, it was nothing, Lily, nothing.
Brother, was your mission successful? Did our leader get his year for meditation in India?
Not exactly. He got 6 months in Leavenworth.
Here's a word from Chesterfield.
You see it in the newspapers. No unpleasant aftertaste. You hear it on the radio. No unpleasant aftertaste. You see it on television. No unpleasant aftertaste when you smoke Chesterfields. It's the biggest plus in cigarette history. Science discovered it. You can prove it. Science discovered that of all brands tested, Chesterfield, and only Chesterfield, leaves no unpleasant aftertaste.
Prove it yourself. Smoke a pack of Chesterfields. They're always milder, better tasting, cooler smoking. And Chesterfield is the cigarette that leaves no unpleasant aftertaste.
That's the biggest plus in cigarette history.
No unpleasant aftertaste.
Science discovered it. Prove it yourself. Buy Chesterfields today.
Listen again next week, friends, to The Magnificent Montague, starring Monty Woolley. The Saturday night transcribed feature on NBC's All-Star Festival of Comedy, Music, Mystery, and Drama. Brought to you by Anacin, for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. By RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, and first in television. And by Chesterfield, always milder, better tasting, cooler smoking, plus no unpleasant aftertaste. The Magnificent Montague was created and directed by Nat Hiken and written by Nat Hiken and Billy Friedberg. Anne Seymour was Lily, Pert Kelton was Agnes. Also heard on tonight's broadcast were Johnny Gibson, John Griggs, and Danny Acco. Jack Ward was at the organ. This is Don Pardo.
Tomorrow, hear New Theater in the NBC Symphony on NBC.
Oh, my goodness. From 73 years ago, August 11th, 1951, The Magnificent Montague here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Coming up next, Superman.
When the family is packing up to go on a vacation or maybe on an all-day trip to the beach, everyone's pretty busy. Dad is sure the car is in good condition, Mom sees to it that food and extra clothing is packed, and of course we can always count on the kids to bring special equipment, everything from a tennis racket to a portable radio. The same thing is true in preparing for possible enemy attack. Everyone should have a job to do and know when to do it. Be sure that everyone in your family is assigned a job to do in case of enemy attack.
Now the continuing adventures of Superman. This episode goes back 83 years to August 11th, 1941, the story of Dr. Roebling and the Voice Machine.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman!
Look, up in the sky!
Bird, it's a plane!
It's Superman! Yes, it's Superman! Strange visitor from the planet Krypton, who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can leap tall buildings at a single bound, race a speeding bullet to its target, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth and justice.
And now to our story. As you remember, Clark Kent, Lois Lane, and editor Perry White were amazed witnesses to a private demonstration of Dr. Walter Roebling's secret voice machine, a highly sensitive instrument able to pick up and magnify sounds unheard by the human ear, even the voices of those long dead. Thrilled by the demonstration, Kent, Lois, and Perry White returned to the Daily Planet building, convinced that Dr. Roebling's machine could well be used to join the countries of the world in a permanent bond of peace. But none of them was aware that even as their car left the elderly inventor's house in the suburbs, that Jack Roebling, his dishonest nephew, who had made one attempt to gain possession of the voice machine, was hiding behind a hedge, waiting for the opportune moment to break into his uncle's basement laboratory and, out of revenge, destroy the only existing working model. With him is his blonde wife, Chickie. At the moment, under cover of darkness, Jack Roebling is using a hacksaw to cut through the iron bars guarding one of the basement windows.
Can't work this blade too fast. She heats up. How's it look, Chickie?
Nobody's coming. Jack, why won't you listen to me? What'll this get you? Maybe 10 years in jail, that's all.
Who asked you?
Oh, wait a minute, Jack.
Let go my arm.
Listen to me, Jack. Just give me a chance to say a few things, and then if you want to go ahead, okay.
All right, talk fast. We haven't got all night.
Remember when you first told me about your uncle and the machine he was inventing?
Yeah, I remember. So what?
Well, you told me he was no good. You said he was out of his head. A crackpot, that's what you called him.
That's what he is.
Well, anyway, you talked me into helping you take his invention away from him. Because the way you told it, it belonged to you, by the way.
What are you driving at?
Justice, Jack. We tried to get it from him, and we were caught. He could have sent us both up for 5 years. He didn't. He turned us loose because he didn't want you to have a police record. And no guy who does that, Jack, can be so bad.
He's still a crackpot.
Well, what if he is? He never hurt you, did he?
Oh, can the chatter. I got work to do.
One more thing, Jack. You're going to cut through those bars. You're going to climb into the basement and bust up your uncle's voice machine. All I want to know is, what'll it get you?
Just what I want. Revenge and the $10 million the machine is insured for.
You haven't got a chance at the $10 million, Jack. And you know it. That means you're going to knife an old man who did you a good turn just for revenge. Well, I'm not.
What's that?
I said I'm not. I don't want any part of it.
Wait a minute. Did I hear right?
You heard perfectly. I've done some things I'm not very proud of, but this is one thing I won't do.
Oh, no?
No. So long.
Come back here.
Sorry, I'm pulling out.
Chickie, I'm warning you. Come back. Okay, you little double-crosser. This'll stop you. Where is she? I'm sure I hit her. Chickie! That's funny. Chickie! I don't get this. Well, one thing I know. She can't take the car. I got the keys. Maybe I missed her. Okay, let her hike into town. That'll give me time to finish the job here. Guess the old man didn't hear those shots, but thought they were backfires. And no time to waste now. Which window is it? Oh, here. Okay. 4 more bars to go.
Come in, Kent. Close the door.
Here's the report you wanted on the demonstration of Dr. Roebling's voice machine. I don't think I left anything out.
Good. I wanted that down on paper while it was fresh in your mind. Kent, that was the most amazing thing I've ever witnessed.
Yeah.
Imagine standing in that basement room on the outskirts of Metropolis and listening to Abraham Lincoln delivering the Gettysburg Address. Boy, it's like a dream.
Yes, it certainly is.
I can't wait to break the story, Kent. It's the scoop of the century. Oh, incidentally, did you understand Dr. Roebling's explanation of how the machine works?
Well, yes, it's simple enough. You remember what Dr. Roebling said about dropping a stone into a pool of water?
Yes, it makes waves.
That's right, and so does sound. Sound waves. Dr. Roebling's theory was that these sound waves never completely disappear. That if he could develop a receiver sensitive enough to pick them up, he could recreate the sound no matter when it occurred. And he's done it.
And that's just the way I want you to write the story the moment Roebling gives us the go-ahead. Simple, you know, so everyone can understand it.
Uh-huh.
Harry White speaking. Who? Oh, hold on. It's for you, Kent.
Oh, thank you. Hello? Yes, this is Clark Kent. What? A young woman. I see. Yes, all right, I'll be there in 5 minutes. Thank you.
What's the trouble? You look worried.
Well, that was the city hospital. A woman was just brought in an emergency case. She keeps asking for me.
Well, that's funny.
Yeah. I'd better get down there. No telling what it might be.
No, I'll go with you.
Okay. Meet me at the elevator.
Dr. Talbot report to emergency ward.
This is the room, gentlemen, but before we go in, I'd like to tell you what we know of the case.
That's a very good idea, Doctor.
According to the police, a motorist picked this girl up on Metropolis Boulevard.
I see.
She was semi-conscious with a bad bullet wound in her back. How she ever managed to stay on her feet is a mystery. She was brought here and will be operated on within the hour. She's conscious now and keeps repeating your name, Mr. Kent.
Yes?
We have no means of identifying her and thought possibly you might supply some clue.
Well, I'll do my best.
Good. We shall go in.
Kent. Clark Kent. Get Clark Kent.
You see? I'll close Kent. The door.
Get Clark Kent.
I know the girl. Her name is Catherine Roebling.
Who's there? Is it Clark Kent?
You may go over to the bed.
All right. I'm here, Miss Roebling.
Oh, Mr. Kent. They found you.
Yes, I came the moment they called.
Come close. It's hard to talk and there isn't much time.
All right.
Jack, my husband, he's trying to...
Just take it easy, Miss Roebling. Who did this to you?
Listen, this is important. Jack is trying to break into his uncle's laboratory.
What did you say?
Yes, he's going through the iron bars on the basement window.
What?
He wants to wreck the voice machine.
How do you know?
Well, I know, believe me, I know. You've got to hurry. There isn't much time. Hurry. Let's hurry. Let's stop him. Hurry.
She just told me something that makes it necessary for me to leave at once, Doctor. I'll be back.
Oh, wait a minute, Kent. I'll go with you.
You better not, Mr. White. This may be dangerous.
I said I'll go with you.
Okay, come on.
And you say this is the same nephew who forced Dr. Roebling to sign over all rights to the voice machine?
Yes, that girl in the hospital is his wife.
Who shot her?
She didn't say, but I think I can piece it together. Evidently, she refused to help her husband break into Dr. Roebling's laboratory to destroy the voice machine.
You mean you think her husband shot her?
I wouldn't be a bit surprised. Hold on, we make a turn here.
Boy, that dirty rat. Roebling should have tossed him into jail the first time.
Yeah.
Kent, I hope we're not too late. Do you know what it means if that machine's wrecked?
I know.
Now, Roebling's an old man. He'll never live long enough to rebuild it.
Well, maybe we're not too late. There's the house up ahead. I'd better park on the driveway. Come on, Mr. White.
Where to?
Well, she said he was sawing the bars on a basement window. Now, wait a minute. Hold up. There's the window. See it with the bars missing?
Yes.
Come on.
Don't touch that machine, Roebling, if you value your life.
Who's there?
Never mind. Don't touch that machine.
I've got a gun and I'm coming to the window shooting.
Get around to the front of the house, Mr. White. Find Dr. Roebling and have him call the police. Hurry!
Okay. Be careful.
I said I'm coming to the window shooting. Stand back.
I think it's high time
Superman took over.
Roebling.
Look out, mister.
Evidently you don't recognize my voice, Roebling.
I'm not kidding, mister.
Neither am I. I'm going to give you one chance to toss that gun out of the window and follow it yourself. Just one chance.
Ha! Here's what I think of you. Here's what I think of you. Here's what I think of you.
All right, you've had your chance. Now I get mine. That gun won't help you. Nothing can help you now.
You won't get me. Not until I smash this machine into 1,000 pieces.
What? I warned you about that. Now you'll suffer for it.
Ah! Let me go! Let me go!
I'll let you go into dreamland.
Mr. Kent.
I better switch back to Kent in a hurry.
Kent, where are you?
Down here, Mr. White.
Turn on the light, Mr. Kent. Pull the cord over the table. What happened?
There. You can see for yourself.
Good grief. The machine.
Your nephew smashed it. I was a split second too late.
My voice machine. It's ruined. Completely ruined. It's ruined.
Tears of sympathy form in the eyes of Clark Kent and Perry White as they watch the elderly gray-haired inventor stand before the twisted mass of steel and wires that was once a monument to his genius. Dazed and bewildered, he turns away from the wreckage, shoulders bowed and head hung low. Gently, Clark Kent touches his arm.
There may be some way of repairing it, Dr. Roebling.
No. No, it's ruined. Forever.
Is the amazing voice machine completely destroyed? Has the blind, revengeful fury of one man robbed the world of its most valuable method of communication? There are strange developments to come in this thrilling story, so follow every exciting episode. Listen in with Superman.
Don't forget, tune in again for the next thrilling episode with Superman.
bird. It's a plane. It's Superman.
More in this story of Superman coming up on Tuesday's Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, along with episodes of The Chase and Sanborn Hour, The Jackie Gleason Les Tremaine Show, and an episode of The Great Gildersleeve. That'll all be coming up on Tuesday. Wednesday, we will have Victory in Japan Day remembrances, along with an episode of Mystery in the Air and Have Gun Will Travel. That'll all be coming up on our Wednesday Classic Radio Theater. So stay around. We produce one of these things each and every day, and I hope you enjoy it. We will see you tomorrow for Westerns and Crime with Gunsmoke, Fort Laramie, I Was a Communist for the FBI, Nick Carter, Master Detective, and wrap it all up with another episode of Claudia. Have yourself a great day. Enjoy your Sunday. Classic Radio Theater. I'm Wyatt Cox.